Welcome to E-Pathshala. Friends, myself, Dr. Vandana Arora, I am Associate Professor with Department of Laws, Punjab University, Chandigarh. Today, the topic which we are going to discuss is criminalization of politics and administration and the police reforms. In rapidly changing world, criminalization of politics and administration has assumed dangerous proportions. Large number of criminals have become a member of legislature. Consequently, the development of nation is adversely affected and the national goal could not be achieved and even the working of the police is eclipsed. This called for introducing reforms in the police administration. Various committees and commissions were therefore constituted to identify the grey areas where the police reforms are required. Let us discuss all these in detail. Now, in this module, we will lay emphasis on understanding the meaning and impact of criminalization of politics and to identify the various commissions and the committees involved in police reforms. Democracy is the most popular form of government where people either directly or through their representatives run the administration of the country. To shape the representative form of government, political parties were formed. India, being an heterogeneous and culturally complex and geographically vast country, opted for multi-party system. Gradually, the electoral process became struggle for power and competition between the various parties now has become more severe. In order to win the election and get into the power, political parties started resorting to illegitimate methods and sources. Use of money and muscle power of the criminal is borrowed to secure maximum votes. This use of money and muscle power and unacceptable practices offend the foundation of democratic system. After coming into the power, the political leaders have to return the favor to these criminals, for which they often neglect the rules and the laws and give undue favor to them. Initially, the criminal worked behind the scene by indirectly supporting the political parties, but now these criminals have started contesting elections and became minister. The country is under the grip of evil like a social strife, violence, rule of mafia, money and muscle over the election as well as whole system. Under these circumstances, corruption and criminalization of politics became rampant in India. Criminalization is a process which changes the behavior into the crime and individuals into the criminals. It is therefore an institutionalized process through which certain acts or behaviors are termed as crimes and outlawed. Hence, the increasing participation of criminals in political activities has led to the criminalization of politics as well as politicization of the criminals. In India, this phenomena has assumed unmanageable dimension and is now spreading its tentacles to the other form of the government like executive and the judiciary. Further, the political influence and the pressure have eclipsed the functioning of the police force. This calls for reforming the structure and the functioning of police. Police reforms are essential to acclimatize the police functioning with the changing socio-political and economic scenario and also to equip the police to cope the changing nature and scope of the crime and the criminal activity. Now, what is the scenario of criminalization of politics in India? Now, criminalization of politics has reached a dangerous level. The Association for Democratic Reform analyzes the magnitude to which criminalization has reached in politics in India. It has been observed by ADR that number of MPs with criminal cases has been increasing. A data has been provided from 2004 to 2009, in which totally declared criminal cases in the year 2004 were 429. 2009, it has been increased to 521. So there's an increase of 92. Regarding percentage, it is increased by 21%. That is, the increased percentage is 27. So, MPs with a declared serious criminal charges in the year 2004, if you go by the chart, is they were only 55. It was raised to 2009 to the tune of 76. That is, increase was about 21 MPs, that is 38%. Now, coming to the reasons for the criminalization of politics and administration. Criminalization of politics has become a serious issue in Indian political system. There is a need to check this trend, otherwise entire system may collapse. There are various factors which gave role to the criminals in electoral process that resulted in the participation in the political system at first indirectly and now directly by becoming the ministers. Political system of India, as discussed earlier, is based on multi-party system where by becoming ministers, candidates securing the maximum number of votes becomes MP. Political parties have to undertake huge expenditures for buying the votes and other illegitimate purposes. Often due to the lack of fund, political parties associate criminals by using their muscles and money power to win the elections. Criminals are often wooed by political parties and given cabinet posts because of their muscles and money powers, which fetches crucial votes. Elections are won and lost on the swings of just 1% of the votes. So parties cynically woos every possible vote bank, including those headed by the accused, robbers and murderers. Loopholes in the legal system cause delay in the judgment, which often result in the death of the accused due to the old age, even before being convicted, and these criminals are regarded innocent till guilty is proved. Corruption is another cause of this malaise. It begins with a high election budget of the candidate. The statutory limit of election expenses is too less as compared to the expenses incurred by the candidate. Therefore, to bear these expenses, candidates often take the help and the favor of underworlds. Once the candidate becomes MP, MLA or the minister, he has to reciprocate to its donor in a big way. This is the root cause of corruption. Indian law assumes innocence until the guilt is established. This leaves the scope for these charge-sheeted criminals who are habitual offenders but yet not been guilty of by the court. Thus, without conviction, an offender is not criminal. So, there is a strong nexus between the criminal and politicians again. Election Commission may take adequate measures to break the nexus between the criminals and politicians. The Election Commission has prescribed forms contestant of election to disclose their property details, cases pending in the court, convictions and so on, while filling their nomination paper. This is a positive step taken by the Commission to make the voter know about criminal history of the candidate, but it has not been effectively applied. These disclosures only inform people about the candidate's background and qualifications, but do not forbid them from casting their franchise irrespectively in the favor of criminals. Thus, there is a need of the strong laws to refrain people with a criminal record to contest elections to authoritative bodies, and also to forbid politicians to get involved in criminal activities. Now, what is the demerit of criminalization of politics and administration? The phenomena has eroded the credibility, effectiveness, impartiality of police functioning. Consequently, the common law has lost trust and confidence in the working of police. Then the thriving nexus between the criminal gangs and bureaucracy and police influence the working of investigation and prosecution agency by patronizing criminal activities. Then existing decline in the conviction rate clearly shows the judiciary has also become the victim of criminalization of politics, since the criminals enjoy political patronage as well. Then criminalization of politics has institutionalized the corruption in the administration, since the politicians go to any length to please the people, mainly business houses and criminal gangs who sponsored the election expenses. Number of political parties has multiplied because the criminal considered it easy gateway to attain power and position to influence the function of administrative system. Then what measures can be taken to check the criminalization of politics and administration? Number of committees on politics and electoral reforms to discuss the ill effect of criminalization of politics and administration. And in order to combat this menace, Vora committee was constituted to spot the degree of political criminal nexus, which was constituted in the year 1993 under the Supreme Court directive as a preventive measure. As no concrete measure were taken by the government, a public interest litigation was filed by NGO Citizen for National Consensus in Supreme Court, highlighting the required changes in the Representation of People Act to limit the criminalization of politics. On May 2, 2002, the Supreme Court in the historic ruling stated that candidate contesting an election to the parliament, state legislature or municipal corporation has to make the following declaration along with the application of his or her candidate. A candidate with a criminal record, a candidate's financial record, the candidate's educational qualification. The Supreme Court has ruled that all these three declarations will have to be truthful, and failure of which would call for penalization. The Election Commission has sent a notification to all the state-level Election Commission officers with a view to enforce it. The thriving nexus between the criminal gangs and the bureaucracy and the police influence the working of investigation and prosecution agency by patronizing the criminals and criminal activity. The increasing criminalization of politics has affected the policing of the country adversely. So we need police reforms in India. Now, police administration is governed by an anarchic and colonial police law passed in the year 1861. The Indian Police Act of 1861 is the basic and the fundamental management of the police forces in India. However, the problem of modern society has outgrown the parameter of the Act of 1861. Further, several present manifestation of the crimes and disorder cannot be handled by this archaic act. This therefore calls for reforming the present police structure. Secondly, the administrative structure of the present police system have developed numerous inbuilt faults such as faulty recruitment system, inadequate training system, defective promotion system, unsatisfactory working condition and so on. Thirdly, with the advancement in science and technology, the nature of criminal activity has undergone a sea change. This therefore challenges both the mental ability and academic knowledge of the police personnel. Lastly, the politicization of police force has adversely affected the performance of police force. Hence, it has become imperative to revamp the police administration to guarantee greater efficiency and efficacy. In medieval period, the system of policing was existent in the form of zamindari system. A zamindar was responsible for restoration of peace and order in its jurisdiction. As a head, he has to keep a check on all kind of criminal activities. He, along with a collection of land revenue, penalized offenders for various offenses such as theft, rioting and so on. However, during the British rule, the power of zamindar were delegated to the magistrates and special police services were created. The British were made several attempts to reform the police. The first step was the establishment of Police Commission of 1860. The Police Act of 1861 was the major outcome and the recommendation of the commission. Police Commission was constituted in the year 1902. Therefore, the following committees have been constituted: Gore Committee on Police Training, way back in the year 1971 to 73. Then we have National Police Commission, 1977. Then we had Ribeiro Committee on Police Reforms. Then we have Padmanabha Bhaiya Committee on Police Reforms in the year 2000. Then we have Police Act Drafting Committee 2005 and 2006. And then we had the Supreme Court's directive. All these committees have been constituted to introduce reforms in the police. Gore Committee on the Police Training. Now this committee was set up under the chairmanship of M.S. Gore to review the training of police force, that is from the constabulary level to the Indian police services. The committee recommended that in view of vast powers and wide discretion beyond the state, the recruitment procedure should be free from political, personal or corrupt influence. The committee stressed the importance of psychological and entry orientations for different recruitment procedure. The various state police commission has also recommended the introduction of intelligence psychological test for constables and sub-inspectors. Then we have National Police Commission, the year 1977. The government appointed this commission to undertake comprehensive review of the role and performance of police in view of changing social, political and economic situation in the country. NPC submitted 8 detailed reports between 1979 to 81, which contained comprehensive recommendation covering the entire gamut of police working. The recommendations in the first report, the commission recommended that the system of functioning of constable should be radically changed. They should be so recruited and trained for undertaking function that calls for requisite decision making and judgment. In the second report, the commission flagged the misutilization of police in terms of interference by illegal or improper orders or pressure from the political executives or other extraneous sources. The commission recommended the establishment of statutory body called State Security Commission in each state in order to reduce the state government's influence in police work. In third report, the commission highlighted deficiencies of procedural laws and the evils of suppression of crime by non-registration of the cases. In its fourth report, the commission highlighted the need for achieving high degree of coordination between the investigating staff and prosecuting agency. It further suggested reform for facilitating judicious conduct of investigation. In the fifth report, commission dealt with the recruitment of constable and sub-inspector and laid emphasis on their proper training. In the fifth report, recommended the establishment of police commissionerate in large cities with a population of 500,000 and above. It also recommended certain measures to improve the police handling and investigation of cases of communal riots. In the seventh report, the commission dealt with the internal management of the police force and recommended that this should be entirely under the purview of chief of police. In its eighth report, the commission recommended that independent cell should be established in the State Security Commission to evaluate police performance in both qualitative and quantitative terms. Besides, the commission drafted a model police bill also, which could be enacted. It recommended that current police act should be replaced. The new law should change the system of superintendence and control over the police and mandate police to promote the rule of law and render impartial services to the community. The recommendation of NPC received a cold treatment in the hand of the government. The political leadership and bureaucracy lacked willingness to give a functional autonomy to the police. Then thirdly, as I have said, Rai Bureau Committee on Police Reform was constituted. And this is in the year 1996. Two former senior police officers, through public interest litigation, requested the Supreme Court to direct the Government of India to implement the recommendation of National Police Commission. Thereby, in May 1998, the government set up a Rai Bureau Committee in compliance with the direction of the court. The committee was review, implement the recommendation of National Police Commission, the National Human Rights Commission and the Vohra Committee to suggest ways and means to implement the pending recommendation and make any other recommendations which it considered necessary. The committee released two reports. The first report was released in October 1998, dealt within the Supreme Court's specific concerns. And the second, more general report was released in the year 1999. The committee recommended the setting up of the Police Performance and Accountability Commission at state level, constitution of District Complaint Authority, replacement of Police Act with the new Act, establishment of District Police Complaint Authority, Police Establishment Board, enhancement of the quality of police training as well. Then there was Padmamaya Bhaiya Committee on Police Reform, and this committee recommended for the replacement again of 1861 Act with new legislation. It make recommendation with different aspect of police personnel administration, that is recruitment, training, promotion, appointment, transfer and tenure. There is a Police Act Drafting Committee, and the Government of India set up a Police Act Drafting Committee chaired by Soli Sabrabji in 2005. The committee was to draft a new Police Act in the light of changing role and responsibility of the police. It has considered the increasing challenges presented by insurgency, militancy and exilism in India. The new act has to include measures to change the police attitude and incorporate community expectations of modern police services. The new act should address the issues of human rights, concerns for women, people belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. Committee submitted the model police report to the Union Government in the year 2006. Then there is a Prakash Singh versus Union of India, whereby in the year 2006-07, Supreme Court has given the directives. In 1996, two former Director General of Police filed in public interest litigation and requested the Supreme Court to give direct the central and the state government to address the poor quality and performance of police in India. So in 2006, the court ruled that given the gravity of the problem and total uncertainty as to when police reform would be introduced, appropriate direction for immediate compliance should be given. These directions are binding upon the central government. With the landmark judgment, Supreme Court ordered the establishment of three institutions at the state level to insulate the police from extraneous influence, giving its functional autonomy and ensuring its accountability. These institutions are State Security Commission, very, very important. Then we have Police Establishment Board, comprising of Director General of Police and four other senior officers of the department, which shall decide all transfers, postings, promotions and other services related matters of the officers of and below the rank of DSP. And finally, the Police Complaint Authority at the district and state level with a view to inquire into the allegation of serious misconduct by the police personnel. Besides, the directives issued by Apex Court with regard to the management of personnel at the top level are as follows. The Director General of Police shall be selected by the state government from amongst the three senior most officers of the department who have been impaneled for promotion to the rank by the Union Public Service Commission. These officials have a prescribed minimum tenure of 2 years. Secondly, the police officers on operational duty in the field like Inspector General of Police of the Zone, Direct Deputy Inspector General of the Range, Superintendent of the Police in charge of the district and Station House Officer in charge of the police station would also have minimum tenure of 2 years. The function of investigating police should be separated from the law and order police to ensure speedier investigation, better expertise and improved rapport with the people. The Union Government to set up National Security Commission for the selection and the placement of head of the Central Police Organization, upgrading the effectiveness of these forces and improving the service conditions personnel. Some states like the state of Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, Mizoram, Nagaland, Goa have complied with the direction of Supreme Court. It must be clarified, however, that directions are yet to be implemented on the ground. Some other states like Andhra Pradesh, Jammu Kashmir, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Odisha, West Bengal have partially complied. 12 states have drafted the law with a view to circumventing the implementation of Supreme Court direction. Bihar police bill is particularly perverse. Uttar Pradesh and Tamil Nadu are also among the non-compliant states. After going through the module, one can safely conclude that the criminalization of administration and politics has gained a strong foothold in the Indian political system. This has a serious repercussions. It has adversely affected the functioning of the executive and the judiciary. It has damaged the internal fiber of Indian democracy. The effort to check the criminalization of politics has failed because the functioning of the police is eclipsed by the pressure, maybe a political pressure or the bureaucratic pressures. Various committees and the commissions constituted for has recommended the reforms which has been so that the police should be kept in seclusion from outside pressure, especially the politicians and the bureaucrats. However, this could not have been achieved because of the lack of the political will. With this, I would like to conclude, and I think you would have liked my lecture very much, and thank you for the same.